begin. First of all, a survey will be emailed to you on Friday afternoon. Please complete it. Also, live captioning will be provided, and I think we've worked out that right now. So please click the CC button in the lower right-hand side of your Zoom screen. Captions do not appear automatically. And finally, please enter your questions into the chat. There should be time at the end for Sam to answer them. So our speaker today is Sam Shields, who is an instructional consultant at the Center for Teaching Excellence at Texas A&M University. So take it away, Sam.
All right. Thank you, Lisa. I appreciate it. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Feel free to escape and minimize if you don't want to follow along. I know I'd like to be able to see people's faces as well. So this is really an opportunity for me to share some of the work I've been doing with groups, with a specific group here at Texas A&M, but this is not just my story to tell. As you'll see here, this has been a collaborative effort between Bruce Herbert at the libraries, Tim Scott, who is our director of the student success work we do here at Texas A&M, and then myself as an instructional consultant at the center. So this has really been a neat collaboration grow out of some student success efforts that we've been doing here at Texas A&M. So I wanted to share our story with you a little bit and then provide time at the end to ask questions should you have any. If any come across along the way, just drop them into chat. And I've told Lisa she's more than welcome to interrupt me should they be timely where we are in the presentation. Otherwise, we'll save them to the end. But a little bit about Texas A&M. We are a land grant institution, and as such, in that bottom paragraph there, it is our intention and our call through this being a land grant institution. We are charged to provide a broad segment of the population with a practical education that has direct relevance to their daily lives. So we take that pretty seriously when we think about broad segment of the population. We are getting close to being a Hispanic serving institution, and our student population is beginning to mirror more and more what the state of Texas population looks like. And so just a quick overview of who our student body is. Texas A&M serves the 71,000 students. That's all students, both graduate level and undergraduate level. So we have a large number of students that we serve. If you look at our undergraduate population, we have just over 56,000 undergraduates as of fall 20. And what we're seeing, as well as many of your institutions I'm sure are seeing, is that our first generation students number is growing. So we are at about 13,000 first generation students. And another area that we look at very closely to make sure we're servicing the best we can is our students who come from lower income families. So if you look at students' families who make less than 60,000, which I believe is the Pell Grant level, we have about 1,600 of those. So one of the things the institution wanted to look at very closely and monitor is, even though we have this huge number of students, are we providing access and opportunity to all of our students? From that, we realized we can be doing better than what we're doing. And so while Texas A&M successfully retains and graduates a high number of students, similar to other institutions in Texas, when compared with those other leading universities, it became pretty clear to us that we needed to increase student retention and graduation rates, particularly in those historically underserved populations, the first generation population for particularly, as well as the lower income levels of students. And so to help students connect to the university, remove barriers to graduation, and help reduce some of that achievement disparity, we embarked on what we call the Student Success Initiative. And this slide shows you some of the main charges as far as when we think of student success, how that is looked at. So one of the goals is to increase that first year retention for full-time, first-time in college students, We wanted to pay particular attention to our four-year and our six-year graduation rates and boost those, as well as decrease that achievement disparity. So one of the things we wanted to really make sure we were doing is intentionally thinking about how we can tackle this. So it's one thing to post it on our website, it's one thing to talk about it, but how are we actually going to make that happen? So one of the things the Student Success Office did was they formed a grant program and they put out a call. And what they called the grant program was Enhancing the Design of Gateway Experiences, or EDGE program. One of the areas we saw on our campus that students were struggling with were those large core gateway courses that most of them enter into their freshman year. And so the focus was then on those courses that are required, high enrollment courses, hence the name, you know, gateway for remaining in the major, or bottleneck areas for student success. Another piece of this was we really wanted it to be faculty driven. We did not want this to be a top-down approach to where there was this group working and then trickled down to tell faculty what they needed to do. We wanted this to be truly faculty driven course redesign effort. Who's teaching these courses, and let's get them involved in the process. In addition to working with faculty, we started thinking about how can we do this with advising as well. So another piece to the EDGE program is not just this faculty driven course redesign effort, but also a advising early alert system to help students know how they're doing, when they're doing, so they're not just hearing about it from their course, they're feeling supported by their advising office as well. And then out of that, which is what you're here to hear about, is some of this OER work and the adaption or the authoring of open education resources. And so the interesting thing about our story is it really came out of this course redesign work that instructors chose to adapt or author some open education resources to truly align with the course redesign work that they were doing as part of this EDGE program. And so we started with biology and chemistry. So our intro biology course sequence and our intro chemistry course sequence, both were the first two to get or to earn an EDGE grant. And I'm not gonna read through all of this, but what we found out of biology's work is they actually did take one of the OpenStax biology books and adapt it for what their course needs. Chemistry has not yet adapted or adopted an OER, but biology kind of paved the road for the work in this. And then the Student Success Office stopped the way they were offering the EDGE grant and really targeted programs. So instead of wanting programs to come to them, they went out to programs. And so after biology and chemistry got started, they then went to math, and math is the group that I've had the opportunity to work with. And so the math work has really been driven by this program redesign process that we go through at the center where I work. And so with the math group, what we did was, you know, what's the first thing you do when you look at a course? You look at the textbook. So the math group went out, they developed this really nice, beautiful rubric for them to keep track of all the textbooks they were looking at. And the very first rattle out of the box with their EDGE grant work was, we don't like any of these textbooks. They don't fit our course needs. They're not adaptable or able to really meet the needs of our students. And so it was that very first charge that they're like, all right, let's write our own. And so all of us came and we're like, anybody know how to write a textbook? And we're like, none of us know how to write a textbook. And so that's when we reached out to the libraries. And that's where Bruce Herbert comes in, because it was actually his group at the library collaborating with our group of instructors to put together these OERs. And it's been an amazing transformation within both of these math courses. Math is just now starting to implement their books. They created one for what we refer to at Texas A&M as Math 140 and Math 142, which is the main math sequence for non-engineering majors. And then biology's book is over here on the right, which they use with, again, their non-biology majors taking their intro to biology. And so biology has done theirs for their course sequence, and math has one posted in our library's Oak Trust, and the second one is in its final edits and will be posted posted later, but it really was this drive to think more deeply about course redesign and truly open access education that drove the need for these, the creation of the OERs that came out of our work. And so I know Bruce works with many programs across campus, more so than just the work in EDGE, but they actually have some OER programs for maybe individual instructors who want to take a look at this that aren't part of a bigger group. And Bruce wasn't able to be here today, neither was Tim. So I apologize, y'all are stuck with just me. But one of the things Bruce wanted me to really communicate with you all is he comes at this from the library standpoint and how the library supports either the program like the EDGE grant or individual instructors who want to do this and would be more than happy to sit down and share more information with those of you who may be interested in how our libraries actually facilitates and maintains the program. And his email is on the final slide for you to be able to reach out to. So there's multiple avenues that instructors at Texas A&M can use to create or have support for their creating of OERs. And what we're seeing is the impact that this OER adoption has had on our students at Texas A&M. So you can see this orange line tracks the cumulative savings based on the number of courses that are now offering students completely free open access textbooks. And what we're wanting to couple with not only the savings numbers is what a lot of folks want to know is, okay, that's great, but is it having an impact in the courses? And that's where Tim Scott's Student Success Office has been instrumental in collecting the student data as far as, is this working? Is it making a difference? And so if you go at that just by numbers, we do not have numbers for math yet. They are just in their initial implementation, but through the EDGE work, biology rates for D, F, and W's are on the left. Chemistry's DFW rates are on the right. And what we're comparing here is fall of 18 to fall of 19 to see, are we making a difference? So if you go back to those student success quantitative measures that we were looking for, you can see for both courses, there's been quite a substantial reduction in percentages of students earning D's, F's, or actually withdrawing from the courses. And so we have some anecdotal data, you know, just from student comments and what we're seeing about, you know, just the remarkable increase of students being able to engage with the courses, engage with the course content by just having access to the book on the first day of class. And I know the math instructors have worked really hard with that course redesign approach. And so that's what we've talked about is really the message that we want to take home and drive for what we're doing is it was really more than just setting out to adopt OERs, but really to take that course redesign approach in addition to adapting or adopting the OER. Because what we're hearing from the students is my instructor is saying the same thing I'm reading in the OER that they wrote. Or my instructor is using the same verbiage, the same wording, showing the same pictures because they are, that's what's also in my book and in my OER that I didn't have to pay for and I have access to from day one. Another thing the math group is doing is they've taken the OERs that they've written and they've created course note packets out of them for both the students and other instructors teaching the course. And so not only do they have the OER, it's then aligned with the notes packets, which is aligned then one step further in math for their online homework system, which then is aligned to the exams. And so we've really seen this nice progression of instructors having more input into what that open access, their open education resource looks like, the flow of that textbook, and then it can better mirror the flow of their courses. The nice thing about these EDGE groups is that it's not we don't have the capacity for all the instructors who teach these large gateway courses to be on the grant committee who does the work. But But the ones who are the course coordinators and the ones who have been in the institution for several years, taught these courses for several years, and really have a heart for student success. What have they found to be the sequence of the content that really makes sense? And then they're able to take those open education resources and align them to make sense for the students as well. And as you can see, if you just go by numbers, it's certainly starting to make a difference. But what's more fun is hearing the student comments when asked. And so I don't have any of those with me today, but we're in the process of getting our IRB updated so we can start gathering some of those student comments, those student feedback, just to help better tell our story of the impact that this design has had. And so with that, I could talk all day on this, but I want to be mindful that we're getting towards the end. So just again, to take home that we have chose to integrate the OER process into a more course redesign flow. And so it's not just to take this OER and let's put it in here, but really think strategically. And as the student success requires, it really does require a systemic challenge to those, a systemic response to these big time courses that we're trying to boost our student numbers in. So with that, I would be more than happy to field any questions you may have or help dig in a little deeper into where you might be interested.
Thanks so much for a great presentation, Sam. We do have a few questions in the chat, and I encourage people to add other questions as well. The first one is, can you explain the $33,000 for both courses?
Sure. So when the EDGE grant first came out, part of that call for proposals was $100,000 given to that group over 3 years. So their first year they received $33,000, second year $33,000, third year $33,000. So both biology and chemistry, as part of that grant proposal, were awarded $100,000 over 3 years to do this work. What we found was that wasn't necessarily enough, because where a lot of that money was used was for faculty buyout to do the work. And so in looking at that, they backed off and actually asked MAF, when they put their proposal together, to submit a budget as to what it would cost. And so that $33,000 per year is where EDGE started, but then they tweaked the EDGE grant process to actually ask the programs to submit a budget based on what they think it would cost, because my understanding was, I didn't work with biology and chemistry, I've worked with math, was that 33 wasn't necessarily enough to really sustain some of the work that they found the grants needed. In fact, math submitted and received, was awarded their EDGE grant, actually came back for a second grant, and the provost office funded it, and it was just for the OER work. So the math actually has two grants to help support the work, because as we know, faculty are terribly busy. And so in order to support and sustain their work of doing this, they were actually granted an OER grant to buy out their time to be able to write.
Great, thanks. So a couple people wanted to know if you could share the rubric from the math folks.
The textbook rubric? The one they used to do their textbook analysis, is that the one?
I assume so.
Let me see. So I'm working for my Google Drive. I'm trying to think where that might be stored. But if I would be more than happy to, once this is over, since this is in Google Slides, I'm going to drop the link to the slides in chat. And what I'll do is I'll figure out where I have that stored, because goodness, we haven't looked at that in quite some time. But yes, I would be more than happy to share the initial rubric we used, or the group used when they were reviewing the math textbooks. And it's one that we literally just created in Excel. And we sat down as a group and we said, you know, what would we want out of a textbook? And so that's what they went out looking for. And the biggest thing we have found is Math 140 is 2/3 finite math and 1/3 calculus. So it's really hard to find a textbook that is 2/3 finite math and 1/3 calculus. And so they just weren't able to find one. But yes, I'll be more than happy to dig back and find that and add it to the Google Slides so that people have access to it.
Great, thank you. Then we have a question. What does the less than $60,000 column mean?
So less than 60,000. So we have a website called accountability.tamu.edu. And one of the things you can search for is family income. And so one of the things you can do is take a look at those number of students whose families make less than $60,000 a year. And so we just want to be cognizant of what portion of our population may come to us with more financial need than we may realize. And so we just wanted to make sure we're being cognizant of those students who, not that is the only reason we're looking at that group, but we just want to be cognizant of how much of our student population is coming from that less than 60,000, so we can just be cognizant. But as we know with anything in inclusive teaching or universal design, what you do for one group is really there to benefit all the groups. And so that's not just one indicator, but it's certainly something we want to be mindful of.
Okay, we have about three more minutes left. And here's kind of a follow-on question, I think, to what you were just talking about. Are there assumptions made that low-income student level students have the highest percentage of failing students? What was identified as having the greatest impact on grade success being first generation or income? Is there an assumption that first generation students are in the lower income?
That is a great question. I don't know that I have played with the data enough. That is the student success office that actually holds that data. I don't get to play with that data, but that is a very good question. And one of the reasons we want to keep what we've learned in looking at, and Bruce and I have talked a lot about this, is the EDGE grant has coupled together multiple things. They've coupled together course redesign. They've coupled together an early alert system. They've also put in there the use of open access materials. And so being able to parse out which one of those has had the impact, I don't know that we're going to be able to get into the weeds of, was it the course redesign? Was it the early alert system? And so, unfortunately, we don't have the metrics to be able to look at, was it the OER that had the impact? Was it the early alert system? We just know that when we've used the EDGE grant approach, we've seen some positive move in the numbers of students being able to stay in and more successfully complete the courses than we had before the EDGE grant. So I don't know that that fully answers that question, but that's what I've gathered from the data that I've been able to see.
Okay, great. I think we have time for one or maybe two more questions.
Sure.
I would be interested in knowing how they handle online labs for the sciences.
In terms of OER for online labs, or just how they do online labs? I am not 100% sure how. I know biology and chemistry obviously are doing online labs, but I'm not cognizant of how they are handling or maintaining those during our COVID time. So I don't know that I'm, OER for labs. My understanding is, as far as biology, they work with their TAs to create a lab packet. I believe chemistry is still using more published textbooks that the students have to pay for. But I would have to, I can touch base with biology and see what they're doing for OER. So Erica, I'll make sure that gets dropped in the slide deck as well.
Okay, thank you so much, Sam. Unfortunately, we are out of time, but we really appreciate the wonderful presentation and the great questions. And I wish everyone a good conference.
Thank you, I appreciate it. So our emails are in here. Feel free to reach out, and we are more than happy to share our story or help answer more questions.